Good morning, everyone. My name is Terry Weber-Mangos. It is May 17th, 2022, and I'm here today chatting with State Senator Bruce Tarr. We're going to discuss his recollections of George's Restaurant, and we're doing this all on behalf of the Gloucester 400 Plus Stores Project. For people who don't know, George's Restaurant has been in business in Gloucester for about 100 years now, and I hear this rumor that Senator Tarr was a regular there, so is that true?
Well, it is true. I used to be a regular, particularly in my early days of being a state representative, which would have been back starting in 1991. And in those days, Terry, it was a real hub of activity of appointed and elected officials in the city. And so I found myself there usually mid-morning. It wasn't early morning, it was mid-morning. And that was the time when there would be a migration from City Hall over to George's. For sort of a mid-morning coffee hour, if you might call it that.
So who are the names and faces that you might remember from that time?
Well, the one that stands out most of all was our former city clerk, Fred Kairos, who used to hold court at George's, and he would lead the effort for everyone to go over there. There was also former city councilor Gus Foote. Once in a while, Bruce Tobey would find his way there. And others would come and go. There was a group of regulars, but there was also a group that would come and go depending on the day.
Right, right. So did you witness any, or did you take part in any kind of like rowdy political debates in there?
A lot of times what I was witness to was Fred Kairos dispensing wisdom about his observations about what was happening in the city. There would be a debate. And oftentimes he was more the moderator of the debate rather than a participant. And there would be a lot of discussion. And a lot of times it was centered on sort of local issues, what we should be spending in the budget, whether a particular street should be one way or not. And it could get fairly intense at times. And sometimes, you know, I think that the coffee and the food became secondary to the discussion at hand. But the food was always an interesting thing at George's as well, because they were well known for their large portions. And in fact, I can recall, I believe it was Ed Sala, one of the Sala family that owned George's. I can recall watching him making an omelet, and he took at least six eggs out of the container. And this was not unusual. And he was making this omelet, and I couldn't believe the size of the portions. And that was not unknown. And sometimes people would say to him, Ed, slow down, you know, we don't need as many eggs, but that was what you got.
Did a six egg omelet come at a reasonable price, or?
It was very reasonable. And that was what was unusual. The prices were very, very reasonable. I would dare say inexpensive, but the portions were disproportionate to the price. It was very interesting. And I can always remember that the coffee at George's was particularly strong. And I can remember Fred Kairos would always try to dilute the coffee. He would get a glass of water, and as we'd be going, he'd be pouring water into the coffee over time to dilute it a little bit. And I remember that. I didn't drink coffee at the time, so I don't know. But it certainly seemed to keep everybody going.
Well, yeah, maybe that was the secret to having kind of a rowdy debate, is all the strong coffee, right?
I think it probably was. And and the debate could go on for quite a long time. And in fact, the only thing that really ended it was the need for some folks to go back to work at City Hall, because, you know, it was usually maybe 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning when we'd be there, and everybody would need to get back into the office.
It could have been a 24-hour thing, where if it was a bar at the time, you'd go back after work, right?
Well, it very well could have, but it was good that there was time for things to cool down between sessions. So it was good that everybody settled down, went back to work, and in some cases went back to work at City Hall, dealing with some of the things that we had just discussed. But it was good to have a little bit of separation in time so that things could cool off a little bit and people could think about what had been said.
Do you have any other favorite memories or stories from your time at George's? It doesn't have to be about politics or... your work, but.
Well, I can tell you at the time, I had been just elected to the House of Representatives. Mm-hmm. And so I walk into George's and I see all of these figures that to me were sort of larger than life, you know, members of the council, you know, people who are considered pillars of the community, and to see them in a less formal setting than at City Hall was it the very first time it was intimidating. But after that, I was just trying to absorb it all. I don't think I ever got a word in edgewise, nor do I think I was ever asked. But I was, you know, very pleased to watch all of this in action and really get a sense of a lesson that has lasted my entire public life. And that is that the most important thing in politics is relationships. And I got to watch people who I knew were friends, who I knew cared about the city very, very much. But in the confines of George's, they could be brutally honest with each other and have these incredibly intense discussions. But I knew that they cared about each other, and B, they cared about the city. And that taught me a lesson that there could be this rivalry of ideas, but that didn't necessarily mean a rivalry of commitment to the city and commitment to each other. And that was an amazing lesson. And I learned it over and over and over at George's. And some days, you know, I would walk in and I'd say, oh boy, this is gonna be an intense day. But it was okay. Because at the end of the day, everybody was on the same side and trying to work things out.
So it's great to hear that you could have a difference of opinion and still be colleagues and still be friends. And
yeah, although if you walked in the middle, Terry, of this thing, you would not think that that was necessarily the case.
I would imagine not. It probably got pretty loud.
and the interesting thing is that, you know, this was taking place in the midst of a very active coffee shop. I mean, we weren't the only people there. So people would come in, and sometimes, you know, somebody would be sitting up at the bar and they turn around and chime in and offer something. And it was amazing. So, you know, everybody, not all the time, but often everybody got involved in the discussion. And it was quite interesting because it was sort of, you had the regular sort of routine at City Hall. Everybody was doing their thing. And then it became time to go to George's. So we shifted gears. And because I wasn't working at City Hall, but you know, I might be there and they'd say, oh, we've got to go to George's. And so there was like a caravan. And then this political discussion ensued, or you know, discussion of just about any subject. And then when it was over, it was over. Everybody left and get back in their vehicle and went back to what they were doing, you know, for the rest of the day.
That's great. Hey, I don't know if you know that I interviewed Bill George, one of the original members of the owners, son of the owner. So he was recommending that we speak to you and said you would have a lot of good things to say about it. So turned out to
be the case. Well, I'm glad that he did, because it was George's was a significant part of my education and civic life. Maybe an informal part of it, but a significant part of it. And you know, George's even now, it has evolved a little bit. You might not find as many political types there, but you still find folks from all walks of life sitting next to each other, and it's absolutely amazing. Actually, Terry, my brother has taken over the mantle of the Tarr family. He is there every single day. So you may want to talk to him as well.
So, your brother Ringo?
Yes.
Oh, I did not know he was a regular there now.
Oh, that's pretty much his office.
I can't speak to him.
Yes, he is. So in my heyday with George's, it was a different kind of a place. It wasn't. It didn't attract as many tourists, and it wasn't as big an operation. But it did have people, again, from, you know, somebody was down working on the docks to, you know, a local attorney that had left his office for a few minutes, you know, to go have a cup of coffee. So it was always a microcosm of the city. But now I think that's changed, where you have an even wider spectrum of people that are there. And so it might be interesting to talk to Ringo, because, you know, there's a regular group, and I'm told that it's almost in the nature of a club where they all meet and George's. So there might be an interesting follow-up to this part of the story.
Oh, I think I'll do that then. Well, okay, unless you have something you want to add.
That's pretty much it. I would just say how much I enjoyed my time kind of sitting at the right hand of Fred Kairos, who was a great statesman and someone who really understood the city, the soul of the city, the politics of the city, the culture of the city. And I would always pay attention. I would sit next to him and he would dispense advice and wisdom and insight. And it was a wonderful thing.
Oh, that's great. Thank you so much for taking the time to do this.
My pleasure. Thank you for asking. This is fantastic. And I'm happy to contribute a little bit to the picture of this incredible place.
I may be in touch with you about your own story, so stay tuned.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Terry. Have a great day.
Bye.
Bye.